Sri Sri K.C. Ramamurthy. K.C. Ramamurthy. Please keep in mind the time and then.
Sir, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to speak on this very important, far-reaching consequence it has got, sir, bill, which aims to replace the existing Consumer Protection Act 1986. Sir, this bill has travelled for more than 5 years from the draft stage to the present stage, and the delayed journey is not in the interest of the consumers. So the Honourable Minister has introduced the bill in the last Lok Sabha, but it was lapsed. This lapse gave an opportunity to the Honourable Minister to tweak some of the provisions to make good by way of changes. So the first point I would like to mention here is relating to Chapter 5, which deals with setting up of the mediation cells and related provisions. And Clause 37 provides parties to give their consent for mediation. So my point is, the bill does not address the fundamental problem of protracted and complicated litigation, which is the bane of the consumer forums under the 1986 Act. Sir, when the bill was being prepared, the Honourable Minister had assured that he would provide alternative system of consumer justice to resolve disputes with the manufacturers and service providers in a simple and quick manner, that too without the help of lawyers. Sir, now you are prescribing something else. I request the Honourable Minister to kindly look into this. The second point is relating to unfair trade practices. The bill defines under Clause 261 what constitutes unfair contract or unfair trade practice or restrictive trade practice. And they're also prescribing punitive action by sending guilty to prison for 2 to 5 years if there is misleading advertisement. But the point I wish to make here is, sir, that unfair trade practices and restrictive trade practices are being dealt by the Competition Commission of India. So does it not conflict with that? The Honourable Minister kindly explain this. So the third point, if you look at Clause 10 in Chapter 3 and Clause 42 in Chapter 4, which deals with appointment of commissioners at the national and state level, the bill is silent on the composition of the commission. It simply says that the Government of India would be done in case of Central Consumer Protection Authority and the concerned state governments in case of state commissions. Sir, if you look at the 1986 Act, it clearly mentions that a person to be qualified as a judge be made as head, and also prescribes qualification, experience, expertise, etc. I request the Honourable Minister to mention details of qualification, experience in the bill itself. So the fourth point is, Food Safety and Standards Authority of India has recently launched Eat Right Movement, the object of which is to eat healthy and eat safe. So the problem is that government agencies lay down regulations for industry and push healthier food options through Eat Right Movement or Jago Grahak Jago. But there is lack of awareness among consumers. I am saying this because consumers complain of not getting healthy food when they eat out or buy packaged food. But when it comes to manufacturers, they say that they produce products which are to the liking of the consumers. So I would like to know from the Honorable Minister, what is the plan to break this conflict between consumer and manufacturer through Eat Right Movement? So my next point is, we are getting huge quantities of imported food consignments. When our food consignments go out, Western countries, including US, reject them citing more pesticide residues. But when we import food items, sir, even though they may be having pesticide residues more than the permissible levels, we are not able to test because FSSI do not have the required infrastructure and manpower to test all imported food assignments for pesticide maximum residue levels. Sir, if you just look at how many pesticide molecules that FSSAI can test, it is just 280 molecules when compared to 500 in European Union and nearly 1,000 in US. So secondly, the problem is that FSSAI is also not able to test these 280 pesticide modules. And taking advantage of this, European Union, US and China are flooding with food items with more and more pesticides. I would like to know from the Honorable Minister what his ministry is doing to ensure that FSSAI at least will have necessary infrastructure and paraphernalia to test 500 pesticide molecules. Sir, I come back to Clause 2 again. Clause 2, 7 and 42 defines the word consumer and services. Here you are saying that service is no service if there is no consideration in the form of money. As a result of this, an aggrieved consumer cannot go to consumer forum or mediation cell if he has not paid anything for his service in terms of money, sir. Does it mean that if I go to a government hospital and if I don't get proper treatment, then I go to a consumer forum and cannot claim compensation? Does it mean that if you do that, do you think the services provided by government hospitals or civic bodies are of any quality? When you give them elbow room, people will not even get what they are getting now. So I feel that monetary consideration alone should not be a condition precedent for any service, even in government hospitals or government agencies. I request the Honorable Minister to kindly look into this aspect. So I now come to Clause 89 of the bill, which provides for penal provisions for false and misleading advertisements. Sir, it is good that the bill is imposing penalties and jail terms for false and misleading advertisements. We welcome that. But the bill is silent on the promoters of such misleading advertisements. There are very many celebrities who promote various products. But if such advertisement is misleading, such promoters are not liable for punishment under this chapter. Sir, majority of children and young men are influenced by advertisements, particularly promoted by celebrities. I would like to know from the Honorable Minister reasons for exempting promoters and celebrities from punitive action. I suggest for consideration and to include them in case of promoting false products. So there is lack of clarity, the vagueness of certain terms such as false with regard to advertisements that has led to confusion, sir. These vagueness can always lead to misuse of power and therein the infringement of various fundamental rights enshrined in Part 2, Part 3 of the Constitution. So Section 18D of the bill provides that no person takes part in the publication of any advertisement which is false or misleading. The vagueness of the term false and misleading could definitely lead to misuse of the powers by the people who are in the helm of affairs, sir. Another term that prejudicial to public interest as mentioned in 19.1 requires clear definition. Vague phrases can be misused by those in power to exert censorship based on subjective notions of morals and values. Sir, one very important point is the main aim of the new bill, I presume, was to introduce regulation over e-commerce in India for the protection of consumers online, as this was not a feature in the 1986 Act. However, even in addressing the domain of e-commerce in India, this bill has certain broad loopholes with regard to the same. The e-commerce industry is booming, as NASSCOM's latest estimates revealed that India's e-commerce estimate was to be $33 billion in the financial year 2017. The government increasing regulation over this domain may hamper its growth as business manufacturers will need to update their processes to conform to a new law. The bill does not provide for the mechanism by which such possible harm to business engaged in e-commerce can be remedied. The bill has completely failed to address the sale of fake goods online, despite the same being a major problem in the e-commerce sector. So my final point, I wish to highlight and agree that it is not an amendment to 1986 Act, but it's a new consumer protection legislation. I only wish that we make this legislation dynamic and should be keeping with changing times and needs. Otherwise, sir, this becomes one more piece of paper in the statute book which the Honorable Law Minister after some time may come before this House for repealing. With these few observations and suggestions, we support the bill. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Sri K.C. Ramamurthy ji.